You here, and it's tonight we're here to honor the life and artistry of Leigh, little Queenie Harris. My name is Amanda McPhillan. I'm the Director of Programs and Interpretive Services for the Historic New Orleans Collection, and we are so delighted to be here at the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation, who is co-hosting this event with us here tonight in the beautiful George Wein Center. So I just want to start by thanking our colleagues here at the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation, especially Rachel Lyons and Kia Robinson Hatfield, along with some of my colleagues. Yes, absolutely. Yes. Thank y'all. Yes. Along with some of my colleagues at the Historic New Orleans Collection who worked really hard to pull this program together, Eric Seifert, Howard Margot, and Nina Bozak. So thank you to them as well. Yes. New Orleans singer-songwriter Little Queenie Harris had a voice that defied categorization. Though she is best known as a blues rock singer, she played with bands of many genres and helped shape New Orleans music for 40 years. Harris was respected as a musician, songwriter, collaborator, and mentor, and her absence is felt in the New Orleans music scene and beyond. In 2022, Leigh Harris's husband, Rick, who is here with us tonight, and also Leigh's son Alex is here and his wife Julie. I'm so thankful that they are here to join us tonight. Yes. In 2022, Rick Ledbetter donated her collection to the Historic New Orleans Collection, where it is now a cornerstone of our music collections. Press photos, posters, promotional material, stageware, and other concert ephemera chronicle Harris's public persona and presence. Taken together, these materials show her influence and ensure that it will live on. So we have a really exciting program here tonight. I know y'all are all very excited to get to it. We start with a panel discussion, and I am delighted to introduce our moderator for this evening, Gwen Tompkins. Yeah. As I'm sure you all know, our moderator tonight, Gwen Tompkins, has been the executive producer and host of the public radio program Music Inside Out with Gwen Tompkins since 2012. This program showcases the unusually varied musical landscape of Louisiana. Tompkins was a longtime senior editor of NPR's Weekend Edition with Scott Simon, and later NPR's East Africa Bureau Chief based in Nairobi, Kenya. Following a fellowship at the Nieman Foundation for Journalism at Howard University, she returned to New Orleans full-time. Her interviews and stories have been featured in The New Yorker Online, The Oxford American, NPR Music, and more. So please join me in welcoming Gwen Tompkins to the stage.
Can you hear me? It's so nice to see you all. I've just been sitting in my house, like typing. This is such a great honor. It's such a great honor to be here, and I knew this house was going to be filled with people, and you all probably sitting out there know a whole lot more about Leigh Harris than even we do sitting up here. But hopefully you'll have your chance to share some of your stories and to talk at the end of the program, at the end of the panel. And then we're going to hear some really great music. But, the fact that so many of us are here this evening to honor Leigh Harris, you in here in the audience and we on stage and the band that's coming up, suggests that we could have gotten together a whole lot sooner than now. Right? As Victor Hugo once said, nothing else in the world, not all the armies, is so powerful as an idea whose time has come. Right? So let's talk about Leigh Harris. And in doing so, I want to introduce three wonderful women. Now, we are going to introduce them each singularly. But I don't want them to have to stand there while I'm talking about Leigh Harris. So let's get to them first. All right. So we have among us Missy Bowen, who dodged a lot of a lot of arrows to get here today. She might even tell you about them. Missy Bowen is, I mean, she runs one of the greatest radio programs in town, the New Orleans Music Show. Her version of New Orleans is the version I want to hear. And she's just been absolutely terrific and so intimately involved in music her whole life here. And she actually teaches writing over at Delgado. So please, let's give her another round of applause. Missy Bowen. She kind of tripped me up a little bit earlier. She goes, did you say Bowman? And I said, no, I said Bowen. But now she put it in my head, so I said Bowman. And then secondly, I'd like to introduce to you the great Nina Borzac. Now, Nina Borzac, I am all over the place, Nina Borzac. But Nina Borzac, she heads Rare Collections and the Performing Arts Collections over at the HNOC, the Historic New Orleans Collection. And she's been intimately, as Amanda mentioned, intimately involved in bringing this collection into the HNOC and ultimately making it available to all of us in perpetuity. That's the beauty of the HNOC and any great archive. And so we really want to thank Nina for being with us today. One more hand, please. And, you know, there has to be somebody on this stage who not only knew Leigh Harris, but who lived, like, right above Leigh Harris, I believe, for some years, and who sang with her, and who was one of her most devoted comrades, and that is the vocalist and great talent, Miss Debbie Davis. Now, the beautiful thing about tonight is that it's not only happening in this room, but it is being live streamed elsewhere. And so what I'd like to do is to familiarize our audience, both here and the audience that we cannot see right now, about this wonderful, wonderful woman. And on a personal note, I have to say the very first concert I ever went to as a child, as a young person, was to see Leigh Harris and to see little Queenie and the Percolators. Yeah, she opened for Gino Vannelli, and it was hot. It's true. I wanted to see Gino, but then by the end of it, I really wanted to see little Queenie. So, oh no! Okay, so, I wish I had a little chair or something, a little table or something, but anyway. All right, we'll sort that out. But, let's see. Now, as you all know, little Queenie was this very tiny woman. She really was when she was on that stage, you know, all those years ago, opening for Gino Vannelli. But she was this little tiny woman from Old Metairie with this voice and this great big talent. And little Queenie, she ended up fronting so many different bands. It wasn't just the Percolators, although the Percolators were worth listening to. They were fantastic. But also Mixed Knots, the Skin Twins, the Jazz Poetry Group, and Leigh Harris and Friends. And Leigh Harris had a lot of friends. She really did. She liked big band music. She liked Joan Baez. Like, who wouldn't, right? She loved Buffy St. Marie. She just liked the fact that Buffy just knocked you out on stage, you know? And she was just this wonderful musical stylist, and she was wonderful at reinterpreting songs. She reinterpreted wonderful songs by Lambert Hendrickson Ross, also by Little Jimmy Scott, by Bobby Gentry, by Randy Newman, and the Jackson Five. But it was her original songs that were what I would call bespoke. They fit her perfectly. And I'm sure you all can bear witness to that. She collaborated with songwriters, including John Magnie, Nick Tenbrook, Cece Adcock, Sarah Brown, Bruce MacDonald, and she sang with everybody. Alan Toussaint, Dr. John, you know, love that chicken, Tom McDermott, right? And the women that she called her Wahini Dakinis. Right? And that includes Susan Cowsill and Vicki Peterson and Holly Benson and Susie Malone and Jan Clemens and Annie Clemens and, of course, Debbie Davis, right? So I'm just very happy to be here this evening to share this evening with you. And the fact that Leigh Harris, Little Queenie, whatever you would like to call her, she never met a music lover who was not a fan. You know, and so I'd like to sort of stipulate that we all love her. She's fantastic. We have wonderful hyperbole that's true to say about her. But right now we're trying to get at the woman. We're trying to get at the artist. And that's what we're going to talk about. And then we're going to have a real good time, right? So I'd like to start with you, Missy Bowman. See, you got me saying Bowman. Dang. Missy Bowman. All right, then. Now, we're going to start
NPR
with you.
Voice.
Now, you know, the thing about it is that, you know, because you have your radio show, because you, you are very, let's say you're radiators adjacent, right? So you have been in the realm of, you know what I mean, of live performance for some time, right? Radiators adjacent.
Debbie, that's a really good point, you know, yeah. That we'll get to, yeah.
That's exactly right. Yeah. And so, you know, putting together a show is not easy. How did Leigh Harris, how did Little Queenie slip into your programs? And, you know what I mean, and what does her music have that you would say is essential to understanding New Orleans music?
So let's put her in context. Okay, let's put what she did and who she is and was. And I'm not the historian, and somebody said this is just, it's too slippery, it's undefinable, this part of history that happened in mid-70s into the 80s, slipping into the 90s. And something really important happened in this city. And it was we had the bedrock, you know, we had Cosmo, we had Fats, we had... you know, the fathers of New Orleans music, which was a thing, basically. And then the young people started, you know, the hippies came and the rock and roll came and the Beatles came. So built on that bedrock began to emerge all kinds of crazy stuff. So we saw the emergence of the rhapsodizers moving into the rats. And a lot of the slippery, you know, with what, 50 people and make up all the bands in New Orleans. But everybody's moving around. And so we had the Raps into the Rads, which was seminal. And we had the Neville Brothers are coming up, right? And we had Booker's up at the Leaf playing God knows what. And but seriously, he because of that voice, he's throwing Beethoven in with, you know, King of the Road. So there's a precedent set down for two things. One is experimentation and no boundaries. And two is impeccable musicianship. And as the rock groups came, you know, we had the Continental Drifters, we had Magnie with Leigh, we had the Cold coming up. So all these bands are going on, Zebras happening. And it's different music, but centered in clubs, okay? We had what? We had Jeds, Tips was over there, and then we got Jimmy's up there, and, you know, all this stuff going on. And so in this percolating atmosphere, what was going right, what was happening, was this really a sense of music, but not just like, oh yeah, let's party and bang on some drums. It was let's out chart the other guy. So you had horn sections, and you had people who really aspired to be excellent at their craft. You had craftsmanship, and that to me is what makes up this enormously fabulous, deep, wide thing that is New Orleans music. That to me started in that time, and it came from a deep thing. And it developed all kinds of other deep things. But that late 70s, 80s world was happening.
And so where does Queenie fit in?
Well, that's, yeah. So along comes this tiny little chick from Metairie, who was a musician, who had it in her heart and soul, and she walked in and was immediately, this was her world. And she came up out of that world and was that world herself. And it was, I think, you know, I'm not the historian, like I say, but if you look at who represents it, as a DJ, I come back now, and I'm going to do a thing on, you know, who played at Jed's or who, you know, Jimmy's. All right, well, who am I looking at? And Queenie is the female that comes out of it.
Right.
Queenie was the woman who was there, and she was partnering with so many musicians, and giving this whole broad spectrum. She was scatting, and she was, you know, singing typical New Orleans stuff.
Right. She was scatting. She was belting. She was
absolutely.
You know, I mean, compared to everybody from Janis Joplin to, you know, to Edith Piaf. You know,
yeah.
I mean, there was just something broad about her voice and something about her confidence on stage that was very arresting.
Well, yeah, and you know, you saw her, and she let you know that it was okay. Like Debbie was saying earlier, it was okay to be a woman, and it was okay to be out there and doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the boys group, the boys club, you know, y'all had the Beatles and all that stuff, but there really were no role models, and Leigh Harris was out there being the role model.
Yeah, I mean, there were role models. I mean, there were an awful lot of women who were working in music.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
I mean,
yeah. I don't mean to be
70s,
flip,
you know,
or exclusive, but
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But definitely. But she certainly seemed as if she was going to be part of that pantheon from a very early age.
Yeah.
And I have to say, I mean, even in, having worked in Washington for so many years, and we've saw so many bands come through at NPR, and, you know, I mean, and no matter how famous they are, you know, I mean, they each come with their own set of neuroses and their own tics and their own, I can't do this, and I don't want to shake hands too hard, you're going to hurt my hand, I won't be able to play, whatever. But when the New Orleans musicians come on, you have none of that. You have people who just walk on confidently, and they begin to sing, and they blow everybody away.
Yep.
And that's what Queenie seemed to do on stage.
Yep.
So let me ask you this, Debbie Davis. You know, I'm asking this question to you because you are the child of opera singers. You sang for many years with the Pfister sisters in these very close harmonies. You have done all kinds of work as a solo artist and working in combination with pianists and other small bands. Talk to us about Queenie's voice. Like, what
is
it?
How long is this interview again?
Yeah. Nah, huh? I mean, how are you able, what is there in her voice that makes you be able to pick her out of a crowd?
She always sings directly in the center of the note. Her intonation is perfection, but she is not hung up on technicalities of form or technique, but she is always right there in the middle of the note, in the middle of the tone. You believe every word she says, but the humor is always there. She is never, there's never one word you don't believe.
So that can authenticity there.
Oh, I mean, there's authenticity that often comes off just as pathos, and that's not what she was. She was cripplingly funny. I mean, one of the funniest freaking people I've ever met. And
on stage?
Everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Everywhere. Her humor was boundless, which is why when she was serious, when she would do a torch song, it was so tragic. Because I forget who, I think it was Groucho Marx who said that comedy is just tragedy plus time. You take the time away, whatever's going to be funny later is just tragic. And so Leigh walked that razor's edge when she was singing. It was funny until it wasn't. It was sad until it wasn't. And you were never quite sure what side she was going to land on emotionally, so you hung on every word. And that wasn't even the sound of her voice. That was just what she made you feel. Technically, her instrument was unique. In ways that are difficult to describe, but here I am, I'm going to try. She had a remarkable range in terms of how many notes she could get out of her face. She had a full belt. She had a low contralto. She had a legitimate mezzo-soprano voice with an upper extension that went into coloratura notes from an operatic range. She had an E-flat on days when she wanted it, and it was terrifying and perfectly in tune and loud. Yeah, driving to gigs and hearing her vocalize in the car was an exercise in joy and terror.
It's true.
Yeah, it's hard to stay focused on shop talk and not gush.
But you know what's also interesting is that she had a conversational tone in her voice, in her delivery. She
yes.
sounded like somebody you would be standing next to at the store, telling you the lyrics to the song. You know.
Yeah.
But then, as you say, she would wow you with this weird range. And you're like, that's not the person I'm standing next to at K&B.
But it totally is.
Yeah.
She would break into song at K&B. That's how we would
find
each other.
Most of us did.
When we would go shopping together, that's how we would find each other in the store if we got separated. We would sing. She would sing like the first part of a song, and I would sing the second part back, and we would find each other in the store that
way. Is that true?
I swear to God.
Oh, can you give an example?
Yeah. There's a part in Stevie Wonder's Too High. Every time the form comes back around, it goes. We got separated in the store. We're walking around Marshalls with TJ Maxx. I wonder where Leigh is. I'd hear.
Lady shoes.
Didn't take long to find us, but man, we got some looks.
I love it. I love it. Yeah. Okay. And so let me ask you this, Nina. You know, you've been handling her collection, right? You've been handling it for some time now. Not just the negotiations, but the actual papers, the correspondence, the ephemera, and all. And so, you know, if you go backwards, because the people in this room were lucky enough where we actually did see this woman perform, but we won't be here forever. Right? So the people who follow us are going to have to look at the very ephemera and items that you now have at the HNOC and put together who this woman was, along with her recordings. And also, what do you make of the parts of this collection that create, that give us a view of who this woman was and who this performer was?
It seems to me that everything that is in her collection very much makes this woman that we know and that we love and that we've heard and that was such a force from we have some early things. You know, there's not a lot of family photographs or anything. It's pretty much Leigh focused. There's an incredible photograph of her when she's maybe 10 years old holding a guitar with some classmates. And then we have a lot of notebooks and writings that she had. And speaking of the Beatles, you mentioned the Beatles earlier. She saw the Beatles in New Orleans.
In 64.
In 64, and wrote a short story, like 100 and some handwritten pages, called And Then There Were Five.
That is so
weird. It is. It's incredible. Oh, so it's, you know, yes, so it's about, you know, Leigh meeting and becoming a Beatle and being in London and it's snowing and it's, you know. So from that, and then in 1966, like 2 years later, there's a draft of a letter that maybe she sent, maybe she didn't send to Donovan.
Ooh.
That really? Is, yes. It's incredible stuff, but you can see exactly, you know, a young person who is very sure of herself and who is musical, it's just all right there.
And writing as a peer. She's not writing like a fan
that's
letter.
Exactly
she's
right.
writing like
that's
Yo
exactly
Donovan.
Right. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
That's wonderful. And so you have brought a few pictures of some of the items that you have. And so we're going to show that. Well, we're hoping that you're going to show them throughout our conversation so that the good people here can see, right? So what's the first thing you want to show us?
So I do have a picture that I brought. The picture of her with her guitar and her classmates. There, so there she is on the bottom left. I mean, it's just the sweetest thing. But you can, you know, I don't know how old. I don't have children, so I don't know. Is it like eight years old? Eight-ish?
Probably
nine?
10 or 11?
Yeah, 10 or 11? Yeah, somewhere 10-ish, 10-ish. And I, what's that?
What school?
I don't know.
She went to St. Martin.
St. Martin's.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And so that's
where'd you go to school?
Where'd you go to school? Right, I know. I should have known that.
In the world.
I should have known that was going to be asked.
That's very true. And all.
I think that might be. Oh yeah. Then we go to the percolators. So we'll go to the percolators later.
Okay.
Unless
if you want
to do it now.
Yeah, you could show that one. Why not? Let's see it.
So we just kind of jumped. I had so many wonderful things I wanted to show, including the Donovan letter, and you know. So you're all welcome to. I know. Well, you're all welcome to come in and look at it for yourselves. So here's this amazing.
Look at that.
I love this so much, right?
Wow, the cast of champions. Now, do we know everybody in this shot? Okay, tell us. Who can tell us? In the
Donovan.
Look at that. This is wonderful.
It's so fantastic. I figured everyone would know who everyone is in the photo.
Look at that. Okay, well, we're going to look at this picture, and we're going to try to figure out who's who. And in the meantime, though, what we're going to do is we're going to look at this picture for a while, but I'm going to ask Missy Bowen really fast, your top five Leigh Harris songs. Top five.
Oh, my God. Oh, that's not fair.
Yeah. You got to use your microphone, baby.
That's not fair. Wow. You know, the thing that I mean, My Darling New Orleans is, everybody knows it. But the one that I always turn to is Providence Provides, which is on Holly Benson and Amacy Miller's record. That is it's about James Booker. And Leigh sings it from her heart. She knew the man. And it's, you know, he ends up in charity and he dies alone. And it's a ballad, it's a requiem, and it's just a truly beautiful song. And if somebody asked me to pick my one Leigh Harris song to carry to the desert island, I think it would be that.
Okay, but we're breaking people's hearts because we don't have the song
right
now.
I know, unfortunately.
But you know, I mean, can you tell us about any others?
Well, there you go. You know, I like all the live stuff, and thank you for putting out all the old. Husband's putting out more stuff, which is super. Stuff that's on Polychrome Junction, I think, is strong. Mm-hmm. That's a record that showcases, I think, her breadth of talent. She has a song on there called Dog Days, which has just got this sly-ass humor, right? You know, well, my two-year-old's finally happy because I got him running naked through the hose.
Right.
What else are you going to do in August in New Orleans, right? but then she also, she does... not Somewhere Over the Rainbow, but yeah.
No, she does. Oh, what
it's a beautiful,
oh, what a beautiful morning.
Morning. And, yeah. Yeah.
And she kind of does the Ray Charles arrangement of
yeah.
that song.
Yeah, she jazzes
huh?
it up a yeah. little bit. And mm-hmm. I think Cloudburst is on that too.
Yeah, and you know what? We have Cloudburst.
We do. And yes. The reason why I popped that one out was because if you want to pick something, as Debbie was talking about, just this, you know, I can't use the word that we would use to describe her voice, but after you listen to it, you go, and right, because, but it's
there's so many X expletives, and Leigh used most of them.
A lot.
Sorry. But you're right, the song does sort of demonstrate her range.
Oh my God, I was
really amazed when I listened to it. I couldn't believe it.
It's powerful. Do you have it?
You have it on your thing, right?
Can I just have to say something that you just said, of course. Something that we have in the collection. It is on the back of a flyer. It's like a handout for someone's yard sale. And on the back, in big marker, big black letters, it says, Leigh, the radio guy says, please don't say shh or on air. So, yes.
Which is like cat. Right.
Yeah.
That was in the liner notes of House of Secrets.
I mean, that's so like catnip to her, right?
Okay, let's see if we can get there.
We can get to this.
We're going to get
you're
to
gonna,
them.
You're going to see them all. Relax.
My heart was dark and I was always wearing a frown because my love had turned me down. Then we met and you can bet I knew from the first you were the one, and that's when your gray cloud burst. My heart really flew the day you caught my eye. I hope that we two will never say goodbye. Clouds of gray have silver linings when they're reversed. You were the one, and that's when your gray cloud burst.
Josh Paxton on the piano, by the way. You'll see him in a little while. That's Dave Ellington. You won't see him.
Dave Ellington, yeah.
She played with her musicians. They were teens.
Hey, baby. You're loving and you're kissing and you're hugging and you're sweet turtle and pretty darling. Won't be satisfied until I hear him play. Here comes the bride. Listen to me, baby. I don't know me, maybe. Listen to my story. It's terrifically true. I want to find a way to work it out with you, and only you believe together. You certainly do. Cause you're thrilling me, really, really thrilling me. Every time you say you might have.
It's incredible jazz singing. Incredible.
Sorry.
Jazz singing. Just, you know, which shows her range and in some ways probably, you know, befuddled a lot of people in the music industry who tend to like you to sing one kind of music.
Oh, right? Yeah.
So
which,
that's,
you know, was part of the problem or challenge, if you will. Nobody knew what to do with her. And in terms of a broader career, you know, New Orleans knew how to embrace her. But the rest of the commercial world, especially 80s, 90s, nobody knew how to plug her.
Right. And the thing is, you know, because she grazed in a lot of grass, you know, that would make her very
like that.
You know,
well
she
done.
Did. She grazed in a lot of grass and, but that makes her a great New Orleans performer, but it doesn't necessarily make you a great national performer, unfortunately, because people have these expectations. And it's not even the listeners, because music lovers will love anything that's good, but it's the business interests who want to put you in this category and her in that category. I read that, that one of Professor Longhair's favorite songs that Leigh Harris sang was the Ode to Billy Joe. You know what I mean? The Bobby Gentry song and all. And so it's like, you know, if she can sing what we just heard, which was Lambert, Hendricks, and Ross, and then go to Bobby Gentry and sing that, that's like incredible, right? Oh boy. So Debbie Davis, let me ask you this. You know, we don't want to leave out the other half of the population, right? You know,
51% actually.
No, 50%. Women make up the majority. So the women are 51. Yeah. But we don't want to leave out. No, I just mean in terms of we talk a lot about Leigh Harris and her, you know, right, and her, you know what I mean, her wahini, what was it? Dakinis.
Wahini dakinis.
Yes, and all. But there were male wahini dakinis, I suppose, too. A number of collaborators who were songwriters as well as musicians, like we heard Dave Ellington. David Torkanowski played with her, Charles Neville, you know, so many, Ron Cuccia, so many people, right? Mm-hmm. So can you talk a little bit about Josh Paxton, as we mentioned, you know, but what she said, I remember her saying in an interview at Jazz Festival, was we all are trying to earn a living. we're all part of so many different bands and so many different acts, you know. And so, you know, can you talk a little bit about what is gained from all of that jumping from one, you know what I mean, organization to another, and what might be lost in doing that?
Well, I mean, what's gained is that you are working in so many different contexts with so many different people, and every shoulder you rub up against, you take something with you and you leave something with them. So you're working with jazz guys, and you're working with bluegrass guys, and you're working with funk guys. She was working with everybody from Peter Holsapple on mandolin to George Porter on bass. Like, she was all these heavy hitters, Johnny Vodakovich on drums, like the big people in their own milieu. She was jumping from genre to genre and punching her weight class in every single genre, and then jumping to another one. So she was gaining everything that the masters of that particular foray had to offer, and then bringing what she learned there to the next one. So there were shades and textures of one style that she brought to another. There's all sorts of jazz in her funk, and all sorts of funk in her bluegrass, and all sorts of bluegrass in her pop, and all sorts of pop in her ballads. I mean, it seeps over. That's part of what makes her appeal universal, is that good music is good music.
Right. That's right.
But what's lost is that it's exhausting work. It's so tiring to have to hustle and to have to remember which head of the Hydra you're feeding that day. I think that part of your identity gets caught up in that, and part of your identity might get a little bit shaken by that. It's hard to know who you are if you're changing who you are based on what you have to do every day.
That's very true.
And also, I think that people's expectations of her were very demanding. And that, I don't know, everybody felt like they knew her very well. And so she couldn't necessarily just go out and do stuff without people being like, "Hey, Queenie, remember the time we were at Carrollton Station in 1978? And she's like, "Yeah, sure do. I'm at the post office. Thanks so much." But like, having to be happy to see people that you had a drink with in 1985, it's a little bit of a tax on who you're just trying to be that day. And
that's,
I think,
true.
That's part of what gets lost, is that you have to be whoever this person thought you were that day, and you're just trying to be who you are today.
Yeah.
That takes a lot out of you.
It's true. I mean, that what you're describing is the cost of success to a large degree, too. I mean, in the sense that, you know, it's what some might call a champagne problem. You know what I mean? Because...
Not in this town.
Well, maybe it'll
it's
be like...
It's a day old beer and crawfish problem in this town.
Yeah, maybe it's a crawfish problem in this town. You know, in the sense
because
that...
Because people aren't like, "Oh, my darling, it's so good to see you." They're like, "Hey, baby." It's not that at all. People feel like they know, and maybe they do know too much about you in a small town. This is a big city, but it's a small town.
Oh, it is a small town, no doubt.
Don't let the population numbers fool you. This is a small town, and living in a small town has its drawbacks, because everybody's all up in everybody's business, and being famous in a small town.
It's true.
It's a full-time job.
It's true, you know, but I remember Robin Williams, he was working on a movie once, and he wanted to go to Burger King, or he was thinking about going to Burger King, and everyone was like, "Well, yeah, let's go, you know, we're working with him on the set." And he goes, "I can't go there. Yeah. I can't go to Burger King. Once I get there, everybody's going to want to say, you know what I mean, talk to me. You know what I mean, about everything that I've ever done, and it's going to become a circus, and it's going to be about me, and it's not going to be about us, and it's not going to be about the Big Mac. No, sorry, the Whopper, and it's just, you know what I mean, and so I'm going to wait for you all to come back from Burger King, and we'll have our Burger King here." And so I think that what you're saying is really important, because it does sort of push you in a way farther into yourself. It isolates you at the same time that it makes you appear as if you are the most popular person and in the warmest environment ever, you know?
Well, and I think that's part of what made her, after the Percolators broke up and after that first big bubble of fame burst, I think that's part of what made it such an easy decision for her to say, no, I'm going to do jazz, and I'm going to do bluegrass, and I'm going to do these other projects, because that's what I really want to do, and that's not what people want me to do.
Mm.
It was 25 years before she did My Darling New Orleans again. Yeah. I don't know if anybody noticed that or not, but people would come to see her at Snug Harbor and go, play My Darling New Orleans, and she'd go,
but you know, you raise a very important point, and in fact, you're in my clutches, because my very next question to you is, you know, nobody has forever to live. What do you think Leigh Harris didn't have a chance to do in her career? A person who had the range that you're talking about, who performed with all of these different people, who liked so many different genres of music. What project was left undone?
I think she didn't get to do a show. I think that's where she was going. I think she needed to do a stage show. I think she needed to do a musical. I think she was such a musical theater nerd. She knew every score to every Rodgers and Hammerstein musical that was ever written. That was up where a big part of her heart lay. And I think it's a shame that she never got to really do anything theatrical in that way. Like, she was a theatrical person by nature, but she didn't get to. Can you imagine what an amazing Mama Rose she would have been? I mean, Jesus Christ, what kind of production of Gypsy would not have said, yeah, that's her right there.
Sit out, Louise. Smile, baby.
That's very true. She was in two films talent, great talent.
She was amazing on film.
Mm-hmm. What, and Eight Men Out
eight
and Passion
out.
Fish?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. In fact, when they were in town filming Runaway Jury, John Cusack used to show up at Ingrid Lucia's gig at the Ritz-Carlton and get drunk and request the only jazz song he ever knew, which was the song that Leigh sang in Eight Men Out. He used to show up every Tuesday and ask Ingrid to sing it.
Oh, boy. Oh, do you remember what the song was?
Of course I do. After You've Gone.
After You've Gone.
She sang it in the nightclub scene, and she sang it in the closing credits.
I love it. I love it. Nina? Show us something else. What you got?
Okay. Let's see. We'll go back. So here is, I just think this is the most charming. Well, that's the thing. There are a lot of posters for Percolators gigs that are, you have the same image, but I like this so much because Spaghetti Eddie's, I don't know Spaghetti Eddie's.
That was so
cool. I figured a lot of people would know Spaghetti Eddie's, yeah. So,
Spaghetti Eddie's was like one of the great restaurants of like the late 70s, early 80s or something.
I didn't get here until 91.
We all wanted to go. Yes.
But I love too, you can see the turkey is talking. And it's Spencer Boren is going to be next week, which, yeah, exactly. Like, that's, you know.
Yeah.
And then kind of going from that, I love this flyer so much. This is from 1977, but it goes back to what Missy was saying about this time in New Orleans in 77 and who was playing at Tips that week, you know.
Earl Turbinton, Giorgio Gasolini, the New Orleans Ragtime Orchestra, Professor Longhair.
Exactly.
Very nice.
And it's sort of exactly.
And that dastardly accordionist, Johnny Zimple.
That's right. Leigh Harris and Johnny Zimple plus Earl Turbinton. Oh, that just sounds fabulous. Absolutely fabulous. It really does capture a time when you could go out and you could hear everything. You know, you could just jump from one club to the other, and you know, it was all dang good music.
Yeah.
All right. So,
Do you want to keep? Should I keep going?
We'll give you one more. One more. Okay. Go on.
Mm-hmm. A couple more. We'll do a couple more. And another like, you know, promo, like press photo, because Gwen, you mentioned the Skin Twins earlier, and so.
And who were the Skin Twins? Oh, John Magnie and
Bruce MacDonald.
And Bruce MacDonald.
Oh boy, they make a lovely trio, don't they? Although they are twins, but that's really amazing. Okay, so Debbie, I'm going to put you on the spot.
Can't wait.
All right, top three, Little Queenie.
Top three, Little Queenie. She did an amazing.
And which one should we play?
She did an amazing record in 1997 called House of Secrets.
Yes.
And. That's a Desert Island record for me. Two of my top three Little Queenie songs are on that record. Paint This Town and Caroline No, which is her cover of a Brian Wilson song that you probably all remember off of everybody's Desert Island record, Pet Sounds. We used to wax rhapsodic about Brian Wilson and how we all thought Mike Love was a piece of garbage because he was so mean to Brian. I still stand by that statement. And she did the most beautiful version of Caroline No on that record. So I think that's the one that we need to play. And my third, I vacillate on my third favorite. Sometimes it's Dog Days. Sometimes it's Oh What a Beautiful Morning. Sometimes... I don't know. Sometimes it's stuff that she never recorded.
Yeah. You know, that's true.
There's so much stuff that she never recorded. I have board recordings that of stuff that we did at Snug Harbor that we never got to record. I've got a recording in my phone that I actually sent to Gwen and Nina earlier today of Leigh and Susan Cousel and me singing Beatles songs with Tom McDermott. And it's magic. I got to look God in the eye and he winked back at me every time I sang with Leigh, and some of that stuff got recorded. So
that's lovely.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're gonna hear Caroline No, a little bit of that.
Yeah.
Yes to Caroline No. All right. Nope. There we go. I don't know how I got to be Caroline.
Save that for last.
The longer we go, you know, you won't be hearing your live music, which is what we
you
really want to hear.
You can buy that on iTunes.
Right, okay. But you know, let me ask you this.
Or at Louisiana Music Factory.
That's right.
Remember, their CDs? It's like the internet made out of plastic.
Oh, my goodness. And so, And so, Nina, you want to show us something else?
Oh, yeah. So there are a couple of more slides that I have of things that just really, Alison is here, and she's going to be performing. But I just love that, again, it's that, you know, that we've talked about, that she, that Leigh performed with so many different people and collaborated with so many people. And I really love that, and I'd like to know the story about this, and if it was a, you know, I'd like to talk to Alison.
About what? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
What? I'd like to talk to Alison about this. Oh, great.
And Lenny Zenith.
But how, you know, with, you know, is it something that was put on? Was it a one-time thing? Did it happen more often?
I particularly like the special PMS discount.
Right? I know.
You
I
prove
know
it.
The special
we'll
PMS
move
discount.
It.
You prove it.
Oh, man.
That sounds totally reasonable.
And then I love this photograph too.
Wow.
At Snug Harbor, and also I'm not sure who everyone is. It's Charmaine Neville.
That's Charmaine. Right? That's Yvette. That's Susie. That's Holly. That's Fister Sisters. Charmaine. That was one of Amosy Miller and his women nights.
Oh boy! So that's Holly, and who is right in the red dress?
That's Yvette Volker in the red dress. Yeah. No, I'm sorry. That's Susie Malone in the red dress. That's Yvette Volker in the black pants with the red belt, and that's Charmaine Neville in the denim dress. Mm-hmm. Holly Benson on the far right in white. I'm guessing that this is probably around the 4th of July because they're wearing red, white, and blue. And who you don't see on the far left on the grand piano is Amosy Miller.
Oh, wonderful. Look, I mean, hasn't Snug Harbor come a long way?
Yeah, right?
Wow, that's amazing. That's amazing.
But yeah.
Same chairs, though.
Yeah. But just to go to that, you know, that Debbie's talked about, that we've all talked about, and how collaborative she was, and she wasn't, you know, as Debbie said to me the other day, there was always room for someone else on stage with Leigh.
Right. Oh, and that's, you know, that's so straight up New Orleans. There's no, I mean, you know, there's a lot of hyperbole about New Orleans. There's no city like New Orleans. And you know what? Sometimes there are cities like New Orleans. But with regard to musicians and how generous they are, when a stranger walks up to them on, you know, and they're just about to start their set, and they say, you know, I play this instrument, and would I be able to sit in with you, or I sing? Chances are you're going to be able to sit in with them, and you're going to be able to sing. And I just think that that's what makes this place marvelous, just that kind of generosity, you know, in an environment that in another town might just be nothing but, a pool of sharks, you know.
But I think what was specifically unique about Leigh was the fact that she was so welcoming to other women.
Mm.
The fact that it was... There was never a threat. There was never, I am less because you are here. There was never the idea that that another woman's voice wouldn't diminish hers. She fostered so much community among female singers on her stage. I sang my first Jazz Fest gig with Leigh.
I love that.
And she fostered so many female musicians into their careers. Annie Clemens, who was 15 years old when she sang on her Jazz Fest gig with the first time with me, was also the first time with Annie. She's the bass player for Sugarland now. She's an internationally touring bass player. But her first time on stage at Jazz Fest was with Leigh Harris.
You know, it is amazing how little Leigh Harris traveled outside of the Southeast, you know, in her career. For a person who, you know, who had this kind of impact on a very musical city, you know, I'm surprised. I wonder where her European tours were, or where her, you know, I mean, world tours were. You know, I would have wished that for her. But we don't have very much time left. But what I would like to do is give each of you an opportunity to talk about a personal experience that you might have had with Leigh Harris. Oh. A personal experience you might have had engaging with Leigh Harris's music or with her in some other capacity, and that's something that sticks with you. And again, you know, I should mention that we do need brevity, but I think that the people here would like to share their stories, but they would like to hear your stories too. Missy?
You know, the best stories you don't remember. Or the statute of limitations hasn't run out yet.
What's the second best story then?
that. Oh, man, I don't know. I just running into her around town. It's the same story that everybody has. You know, she was a friend the minute I met her. I came late to the dance. You know, I was running a radio station up in Colorado, and then I moved to New Orleans, and it was sort of like everybody I knew from there was here, and it was, and there was this amazing woman, and she just, like Debbie said, opened up her arms, gave me a hug, and we were there. And so every time I saw her, that hug, and that smile, and that just sassy attitude. She taught me something. Seriously, women can have balls, and that came from her. So yeah.
And that was at the grocery store, you said? You know what my next question is going to be. What grocery store was it?
No, I think it might have been a K&B.
Oh, okay, K&B. I miss K&B. All right, then. And so who would like to go next? Nina?
Yeah, I'll go next. You know, I had only met Leigh a couple of times, and that was, you know, ages ago. And it was the same, you know, very warm, very welcoming, and just made me feel immediately very comfortable. But getting to know this collection has really been, you know, just really amazing. And to see these, you know, to see so many of these things that I've shown, you know, to see this, I mean, this photograph in particular, you know, her openness to other people. And to other performers and to other women, and also the photographs, that every photograph from the first one that I showed with her guitar, you just see a light, you see an energy. There is something there that is where you just kind of feel like you know her, like she's kind of just looking through the lens to you.
I love that.
I'm going to show the last slide that I wanted to be a surprise, but everyone saw it already.
All right, let's see.
Right?
That's great.
Yeah.
She was a maniac. Yeah.
This energy, this light, you know, it's very special and irreplaceable.
Yeah. And Debbie Davis?
Okay, I've been sitting here trying to figure out which one I was going to tell you guys. Which one I can tell you guys. So there was a while back there, Bose was doing a series of recordings to do demonstrations in their cars. They were doing stereo systems for Mercedes and BMWs. And they did a series of bespoke recordings so that would show off what their stereo systems could do in their cars. Like, this was back when everybody had money and apparently a lot of cocaine. I'm not sure what made everybody think this was a good idea, but there they were, oh, we'll make our own records. So somebody spent $40,000 to make a record to play in a car. So we're making this big band record, and I somehow got the ear of the guy who was in charge of it and convinced him that he should let us do a duet. Let Leigh and me do a duet of "Swonderful," the George Gershwin, George and Ira, yes, and his lovely wife Ira. So I had worked out this vocal arrangement with the big band chart that they had, and Leigh and I came in to record it, and we were doing it live with the band, and we had rehearsed it, and we knew how it was going to go, and it was going to be great, and this was all my harebrained cockamamie idea. And we started the recording, and I flubbed the first take. Okay, take two, no big deal. Went back. I blew the second take. No big deal. Third take. I'm blowing it. I'm like, it's a nightmare. Leigh takes me in the next room, so the mics can't pick us up. And she goes, "What's going on?" I'm like, I don't know. I'm losing it. I don't have it. I don't know what. She goes, "Look, the hard part's over. You campaigned for this. You talked them into it, or you made them think it was their idea, or you did whatever you had to do to make this thing happen. It's happened. Like, it's already passed."